knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Now that we've discussed the stresses that affect Earth's rocks, let's go into detail about the different layers of Earth. On the surface, Earth may seem like a relatively stable place, with the occasional earthquake or volcanic eruption, but our experiences are limited to the uppermost part of Earth, the crust. Earth's crust comes in two varieties, continental and oceanic. Continental crust is felsic, or rich in silica, and is around 20 to 70 kilometers thick. Oceanic crust is mafic, or rich in iron and magnesium, and is around 5 to 10 kilometers thick. However, the most important difference between oceanic and continental crust is their density. Oceanic crust is more dense than continental crust. Therefore, when a piece of oceanic crust collides with continental crust, the oceanic crust slides beneath the continental crust in a process that we've mentioned called subduction. The subducted oceanic crust will then sink deeper and deeper into the mantle until eventually reaching the bottom of the mantle. Oceanic crust is constantly being subducted and therefore destroyed. There are large areas of ancient 4-billion-year-old continental crust called cratons, but the oldest oceanic crust is only 340 million years old. Below the crust is the mantle, a solid but malleable layer with temperatures reaching 3,500 degrees Celsius and pressures up to a million times greater than atmospheric pressure. Although the mantle is solid, over millions of years, it convects like the world's largest lava lamp as Earth's primordial and radiogenic heat is transferred to the surface and radiated to space. Mid-ocean ridges and rift zones form beneath large areas of hot upwelling mantle, while subduction zones form beneath areas of cold sinking mantle. When subducting oceanic crust sinks into the mantle, it creates a suction-like force in its wake, which pulls the subducting slab further into the mantle. This slab-pull force is driven by buoyancy, due to oceanic crust becoming more dense with age. Eventually, it becomes more dense than the mantle beneath it, which is when subduction can begin. According to the current scientific consensus, slab pull is the main force that causes plate tectonics. The mantle extends from 70 to 2,900 kilometers below the surface and is mainly composed of an ultramafic rock called peridotite, which is mainly composed of the mineral olivine, or MgFeSiO4. Geologists have found xenoliths, or strange rocks, of peridotite in massive volcanic eruptions. By analyzing the minerals in peridotite, scientists can determine what depth the peridotite came from. Diamonds, for example, are formed at depths of about 150 kilometers or deeper, and are primarily found in another ultramafic xenolith called kimberlite. At the bottom of the mantle lies a very mysterious but geologically important layer called D double prime. This layer is marked by a large thermal gradient and an increased heterogeneity. The exact nature of this layer is unknown, but there are some hypotheses. Some believe that the D double prime layer is the slab graveyard, or the place where subducted slabs eventually settle. Some believe that mantle plumes, or cylindrical areas of hot rising mantle, initiate from within D double prime in areas where there is increased heat flux from the core. Mantle plumes have caused some of the largest volcanoes in Earth's history, with modern examples being located in Hawaii, Iceland, and Yellowstone. The accumulation of subducted slabs at D double prime also has implications for triggering magnetic field reversals, but before we get there, we must discuss the core. At 2,900 kilometers, the D double prime layer gives way to a liquid outer core composed mainly of iron and nickel. Here, temperatures reach 5,500 degrees Celsius and pressures exceed 300 million times the atmospheric pressure on the surface. Since this layer is a liquid, it can easily convect, carrying heat from the inner core into the mantle through the D double prime layer. The rotation of Earth on its axis further modifies the flow and creates large cylindrical helices. Since iron is an electrically conductive material, when it swirls through Earth's magnetic field, it creates an electric field, which in turn creates an additional magnetic field, strengthening the original field. This is called the geodynamo, and it is how Earth maintains its magnetic field. The geodynamo does require a seed magnetic field to get going, which was likely provided during the T Tauri stage of the early Sun. At 5,100 kilometers, the pressure becomes so great that iron is forced into the solid phase. This boundary is called the Bullen discontinuity, and it marks the division between the liquid outer core and the dense, solid inner core. The inner core is about the size of the moon and has a temperature equivalent to the surface of the sun. Though the inner core does not generate a magnetic field, it does help lock in the field lines and stabilize the magnetic field generated in the outer core. The inner core also rotates faster than Earth as a whole. This phenomenon is called superrotation. It is thought to be caused by rotating magnetic fields in the outer core exerting a magnetic torque on the inner core, similar to how an induction motor works. Magnetic fields induce electric fields in conductors, and the created electric field manifests an additional magnetic field that interacts with the original magnetic field. In an electric motor, the stator windings produce a rotating magnetic field, and the rotating magnetic field induces an electric current in the rotor, which induces a secondary magnetic field that interacts with the original rotating field, causing the rotor to spin, as it is dragged along by the rotating magnetic field of the stator. Earth's magnetic field undergoes periodic reversals where the field strength drops to near zero and the poles switch. Failed reversals also occur, where the field strength drops to near zero and the original field eventually reestablishes. The last reversal was around 780,000 years ago, and we may be due for one soon. It is not known what triggers magnetic reversals. One hypothesis is the sudden collapse of large amounts of cold subducted slabs into the D double prime layer, which can reorganize outer core convection, altering the magnetic field. Now that we know all about the Earth's layers, let's discuss how they formed. When Earth first accreted, it was an extremely hot, homogeneous planet, since the material present was primarily chondrite meteorites. At some point early in its history, the combined heat of radioactive decay and kinetic energy of the accretion process caused Earth to melt. The process of differentiation was then able to begin, with the heaviest materials, like iron and nickel, sinking toward the center of the Earth, and the lightest materials, like silicon and oxygen, rising toward the surface. Eventually, Earth cooled enough to where the crust and mantle crystallized, with the core remaining entirely molten for a long period of time. The start of crystallization of the inner core is debated, with estimates ranging from about 2 billion to 570 million years ago. Earth has been cooling, radiating its heat to space, since its formation. At the moment, the inner core is growing at a rate of a millimeter per year, as the liquid iron in the outer core solidifies, forming new crystals of solid iron. If Earth were to exist in 91 billion years, the Earth would have an entirely solid iron core, and Earth's magnetic field would be gone. However, it's likely that the Sun will engulf the Earth in a red giant phase long before then. A poetic end to our hero's journey, and an amazing sight for any sentient beings that were able to escape the same fate by venturing into the cosmos. So, with this overview of Earth's structure complete, let's go into more detail about the physical properties of each of Earth's layers, and how geologists can detect those properties with seismic waves.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.